No one is held accountable for their murders. We live in a country where 1,000 people every single day are deported, sisters and brothers, in this country. Donald Trump ain't even the president yet. So I want us to be idealists, and I want us to want to work for a better country, but I also want us to be realists and understand who we are, what country we live in, and what horrible things we've done, and what horrible things we continue to do to people of color in this country. Lately, I've been reflecting on my children. And my children are 17, 15, and 12. So on 9/11, my son was only 2 years old. My children only know a post 9/11 America. That's all they know. They know that they live in a country where people tell them they don't belong here, that their religion belongs on some other side of the world. They live in a country where people tell them that they're not enough. They live in a country that has created laws and policies to target their communities and criminalize the communities they come from solely based on their religion or their perceived religion. They live in a country where they watch their faith demonized and vilified on primetime television almost every single night. They live in a country where in their classrooms around the anniversary of 9/11, every child in their class looks back at them, where they feel like they have to defend 1.7 billion Muslims in this world. We live in a country where 7, 8, 9, 10-year-old Muslim children want to watch presidential debates. They want to know what their future holds for them. This is what my children know. They know nothing else. This is the only world that Muslims and young Muslim children in this country know. You know, these feelings are not new feelings. There have been communities before ours, before Muslim Americans, who have felt the same, including our sisters and brothers in the Japanese American community. And they've experienced it in much, much worse ways. I was recently giving a keynote speech at Cleveland State University for a Muslim Student Association. It was a beautiful dinner, and it was a celebratory dinner of the work that they've done for the past year. And this young boy, maybe 20 years old, stood up in that dinner and he wanted to ask me a question. And he said, "Sister Linda, I want to know who was living in this country at the time of Japanese internment. Who were those Americans that lived here and allowed for their Japanese American sisters and brothers to be picked up from their homes with their children and put in camps? Who were those people? Who lived here at that time?" I didn't have an answer for the question. I don't know if the young person was actually looking for an answer. I think he wanted to ask that question in public. He wanted people in the room to hear him ask. And he sat down. And I said to him, "I don't know. I don't know who those silent people who sat back and allowed this to happen to our Japanese sisters and brothers. And I hope that 30, 40 years from now, that there aren't people asking who lived here in 2016 and 2017 and 2018. Who were those people that lived here and allowed for horrible things to happen to immigrants, to Mexicans, to Muslims, to black people? I don't want anyone asking those questions, sisters and brothers, about our generation. I want there to be no question like that, because the answer is going to be that we stood up. And when we mean and say never again, we mean never again." And that question haunts me. Like, you know, when you sit sometimes and like it just comes to you and you hear that voice asking that question, it haunts me. You know, amidst, you know, all of this, and people, you know, see me and they say, you know, "Look, this work that we do, and you know this very well, particularly people who are at the forefront of civil rights movements in this country, this is not luxurious work. I have registered death threats with the FBI. I have people who want to silence my voice for the virtue of who I am. I have people that ask me the same questions, Chris. They say, look, they say, you Arab American, you Palestinian American, you Muslim, why are you out here for these black folks? I say to people, instead of you asking me why I'm out here for these black folks, why are you not out there for these black folks? People say, you know, all these things that your community goes through, the attack, people watch this online, I get attacked in public. People have even got no shame in the attacks. And people say, you know, where do you get this spicy from? You know, why do you still do this? Why are you so loud? Why are you so proud? Where do you get the courage from? And I tell people, I don't think it's courage. It's something I've thought about a lot. And I found a word for it. The word is audacity. Sisters and brothers, I have the audacity to believe that I can change this country for the better. I have the audacity to speak truth to power and stand against injustice, regardless of who that injustice is being committed against, and regardless of who is committing that injustice.
Asian Law Caucus,
that this donation that you put here today isn't just some form of charity at a nice event, that this is an investment in the future of our country. It is an investment in the fight for our lives in a time that's coming that's going to be way worse than you've ever seen. But I believe that it's gonna get worse because the better days are yet to come, and they are going to come at our hands, the hands of people who love justice, people who see each other, in each other, in a community like ours that believes that we have the power to make this country truly the greatest nation on earth. Thank you for bringing me here today. Thank you for allowing me to be in your space. And I recommit myself today, my mind, my body, my soul, everything that I have to you, my Asian American sisters and brothers, and to the work that you've already done to support your Muslim sisters and brothers, to support Black lives, to support Latinos in this country. You've been there, you know what it feels like, and I am encouraged and I am hopeful because I've watched your resilience, I've watched your struggle, and here you are standing tall and strong and ready to have our back. So congratulations and thank you very much.